beginning of a new week. Wow. Wow, what a week. I'm just going to tell you, it has been such a week for me, you guys. Last Monday, this time, oh, it's already 5 o'clock. Well, anyway, last Monday, I filmed the content that is now available on my main channel. I love it. I'm just going to say, it's like the proudest thing that I've created. I've not been this happy or proud of myself since 2011. And yeah, it's just really good. And I sent it to some friends and family, and the response I am getting is out of this world. So big things do happen when you stand up for yourself, you like follow the joy, you follow the spark, you follow that solar excitement, and you be brave, and you follow Glennon's advice, and you put yourself out there. Okay, we are on page 313. That's super exciting. There is only 20 pages left. Oh, sadness. Okay, let's get into it. Seconds. Sometimes, when a heated conflict arises between Abby and me, we stop talking. Take a breath and say to each other, okay, let's not first marriage this, let's second marriage this. What we mean is, let's not go on autopilot here. Let's use what we've learned and apply it. Let's be careful and wise and put our egos aside and remember that we are on the same team. Now that we know better, let's do better. I would have described myself as the spiritual director of my first marriage. I had the vision for our plot, and Craig fucked it up. I now understand that this is because each person has their own plot. No one can be a supporting actor in someone else's storyline. They can pretend to, but they will always have subplots brewing inside and unfolding outside. I am very controlling. I want to control things. This is because I am afraid. Things feel so precarious. When I was young, I made myself feel safer by controlling my food and body. I still do that. But as I got older and became a wife and a mother, I found another thing to try to control to create safety. My people. Since life is scary and precarious, controlling people I love felt like the responsible thing to do. In addition to the fear factor, there is something else that leads me to want to control things. And that is my belief that I am very smart and creative. I really do believe I have good ideas and that people would do best if they got on board. This kind of control is called leadership. For a long while, I have controlled and led my people and called that love. I loved my people to a bloody pulp. My role in the lives of the people I love has been as follows. I exist to make all of your hopes and dreams come true. Let's sit down and take a look at this comprehensive list of hopes and dreams I've created for you. I have been paying very close attention, and trust me, I see you, and I know you better than you know yourself. You can do anything I put your mind to. Let us begin. But we cannot feel and know and imagine for other people. This is what I am trying to understand. The person who is teaching me, that is my wife. My wife... Shh, stop. I don't understand why it still makes the sound, even though I turned the thing off to not make any sounds. Or maybe that was my phone this time. I'm sorry. There we go. Not bad. Since life is scary and precarious, controlling people I love felt like the responsible... Oh, here we go. We were already there. But we cannot feel and know and imagine for other people. This is what I am trying to understand. The person who is teaching me this is my wife. My wife is uncontrollable. I love my life more wildly than I have ever loved a grown human in my life. Before I met her, I wasn't even all that afraid of dying. Now the thought of death panics me daily. Not because of death itself, but because the idea of not being with her. Death, to me, is the ultimate FOMA, fear of missing Abby. Since I love Abby the most, it follows that I have to control her the most. I want to make all of my dreams for her come true. I just really want my best for her. To that end, I have relentless good ideas to share with her about what she should do to wear and eat and how she should work and sleep and read and listen. But every time I try to share my good ideas, overtly or covertly, she somehow knows what I'm doing, calls me out on it, and categorically rejects my efforts. She does this gently. She says things like, "I see what you're doing there, babe. I love you for the effort, but no, thank you, I'm good." For the first year of our marriage, I assumed that that was just a fresh, exciting challenge. I assumed that my job was to find new ways to approach her. Here is an actual conversation with my sister during my first year of marriage in response to the problem of Abby's continuing to insist that she... I told you to be quiet! Speaking of things that refuse to be controlled. How unprofessional of me, folks. But not gonna lie, we're like, what, 26 into it? Not too bad. Okay. Here's an actual conversation with my sister during my first year of marriage in response to the problem of Abby's continuing to insist that she was the boss of herself. Me. Okay, I hear you, but what if I actually know my idea is better for her than her idea is for her? Should I just pretend to think her idea is good? Should I just smile and let her try her idea so we can get to mine when hers doesn't work so well? How long will I have to carry on with this time-wasting charade? Sister. Oh my god. Okay, if that's how you have to think of it, Glennon, then yes. Try that. Try to fake it till you make it. So that is what I did. I just smiled and faked it. I let her lead, but only because it was my undercover leadership strategy. I decided that we would try things her way for a while we both saw the light together. For a solid year, we were spontaneous when I preferred a plan. We were trusting of people when I was skeptical. We took big risks even when I had already calculated that the odds were against us. We let the kids try things I was sure they'd fail at and then resent us for forever. We lived for a while as if life were less precarious than it is. As if people were better than they are. As if our kids were tougher than I believed them to be. And as if things generally work themselves out. It was reckless and ridiculous and irresponsible. Things do not work themselves out. I work things out. I work them out. And if I don't, there is no working out at all. There is just chaos. I took lots of deep breaths and started a daily yoga practice to deal with my anxiety. I waited for things to fall apart so I could save us. I kept waiting. Damned if things didn't generally just keep working out. Damned if I didn't start feeling happier. Damned if our children didn't become braver, kinder, more relaxed. Damned if our life didn't get more beautiful. It was annoying as hell, honestly. I really think that it is possible that Abby has good ideas. I am beginning to unlearn what I used to believe about control and love. Now I think that maybe control is not love. I think that control might actually be the opposite of love. Because control leaves no room for trust. And maybe love without trust is not love at all. I am beginning to play with the idea that love is trusting, that other people feel, know, and imagine too. Remember, those are the chapters of the book during part two. Exciting callback. Maybe love is respecting what your people feel, trusting that they know, and believing that they have their own unseen order for their lives pressing through their skin. Maybe my role with the people I love is not imagining the truest, most beautiful life for them and then pushing them toward it. Maybe I'm just supposed to ask what they feel and know and imagine. And then, no matter how different their unseen order is from mine, ask what I can do to support their vision. Trusting people is terrifying. Maybe if love is not a little scary and out of our control, then it is not love at all. It is wild to let others be wild. Ugh, Glennon, I love your work. I love your words. I love everything that you have to share with us. I can feel the magic in my life right now. I have to say that. I was so scared to let my authentic self be seen, be out. But I did, and I sent the video to some friends from college who, like, I don't know, you know, it was Indiana, and, you know, they're not the same people that were in the Chi Alpha group that I was in. I mean, they are the same, they were in the same group, but they're not the ones that I'm thinking of in my head. We're still friends, let's put it that way, you know? And just their response back to me about just, like, seeing me, myself, my joy, my authenticity. Oh, I really appreciate their feet. Like, just that I put my, that's what it is that I put myself out there. I was scared to put myself out there. I showed myself to those who I love most, and they see me and they responded with big wide open arms. And that is all I've ever wanted. That is all I've ever wanted. And that's what I want to give to the world. And that's what I want to give to you. Oh, so let's read one more chapter. And then tomorrow might be... Let's see. What's our timing like? Okay, well, we'll see. But we're getting to the end, folks. One night after dinner, Abby, Craig, my sister, her husband, John, and I sat around the kitchen table for hours. Music played in the background. The kids chased honey around the family room, and all of us sipped tea or wine and laughed until it hurt. I pulled honey into my lap, turned toward Craig, and said, "I want to tell you something." Everyone at that table felt quiet. "Do you remember that day, 18 years ago, when we sat side by side on my front porch, me nauseous from morning sickness and you nauseous from shock, trying to decide what to do? Do you remember how you broke the silence? You said, 'I've been thinking. What if we don't get married?'" Shush it! Holy mackerel, this has not been the video without digital interruptions. I am so sorry. Let's try that again, folks. "Do you remember how you broke the silence? You said, 'I've been thinking, what if we don't get married? What if we just live separately and raise the baby side by side?' You knew. A week before I found out I was pregnant, my friend Christy asked me how it was going with you. I said, 'We have to break up. We can't connect. Not physically, not emotionally. It's just not there.' I knew. But I had this idea. A vision of what a family should look like, what you should want, who you should become. My imagination became a dangerous thing when we let it eclipse our knowing. We were so young and afraid back then. We hadn't yet learned that knowing never goes away. It just stays there inside, solid and unmoving. It just waits as long as it takes for the snow to settle. I am sorry that I ignored our knowing. We didn't fit together. We tried because it was the right thing to do. Because we thought we should. Because I thought we should. But right is not real. And should is a cage. What's wild is what is. Our knowing was right all along. What is lasted. Because here we are trying your idea. People being two people who are not made for each other, but who are a hell of a team at raising kids side by side. I hope that whatever you do next is born from you and not imposed on you. I hope the rest of your life is an idea. I hope the rest of your life is your idea. For what it's worth, I hope you trust yourself. You know what you know. You have good ideas, Craig. Okay, one more. And then tomorrow's it. I'm not gonna cry. I'm not. Sidelines. My wife and ex-husband play on the same adult league soccer team on Wednesday nights. After dinner, we pack up the car with chairs and snacks, and the kids and I sit on the sidelines and watch their dad and their bonus mom work together to score goals. A few weeks ago, the kids and I were sitting on the sidelines and an older couple sat down next to us. The woman pointed toward my girls and asked, "Are those your daughters?" "They are," I said. "Is their dad out there playing?" "Yes, he is. That's him," I pointed to Craig. "Where do you all live?" "We live right here in Naples, but separately. He and I are divorced now." "Oh, wow, that's wonderful that you still come watch him play." "Yes, we love watching him play. Also, the girl's mom is playing. We come to watch her too." The woman looked confused. She said, "Oh, I thought you were their mom." I said, "I am. That's their other mom." I pointed to Abby. The woman looked closely. "Good Lord," she said. "That woman looks exactly like Abby Wambach." "That woman is Abby Wambach," I said. She said, "Wow, your ex-husband is remarried to Abby Wambach? Close." "I'm married to Abby Wambach." It took her a minute, a full minute of quiet. Selah. Old structural ideas burning, a new order of things being born inside her. Then she smiled. "Oh, wow," she said. Tish's first word was wow. On an early December morning in Virginia, I pulled her out of her crib and walked her over to the nursery window. I lifted the shade, and we both saw that the backyard was covered in white. It was her first snow. Tish's eyes got big. She reached out her hand to touch the cold window, and she said, "Wow." When people encounter our family, their eyes get big and they say, "Wow," in one tone or another, because they haven't seen a family exactly like ours before. Our family is specific because we are specific people. We did not use a blueprint created by someone else and then struggle to fit each of us inside. We create and recreate our family again and again. From the inside of us, inside of each of us. Oh, wow, that was a weird sentence. We create and recreate our family again and again, from the inside of each one of us out. We will continue to do that forever, so each of us will always have room to grow and still belong. That is what family is to me, where we are both held and free. Beautiful, beautiful words. Look at that, folks. Okay, tomorrow is the big day. I missed you yesterday. I'm not going to lie. I really didn't know, like, in the future. I mean, at this point now, but also in the future, no one's really going to notice that I wasn't here yesterday. But that was because I was creating Wearing Reminder for the First Time video, which if you haven't watched yet, please go watch it. I'm so proud of this. I have spent probably like somewhere between 99 and 103 hours. I can go do the real math, but I've like in six, seven days. That was crazy. Mad scientist energy right there. Definitely focusing the power of the autism hyperfixation, you know? But anyway, that was fun. So we're gonna finish this tomorrow. I can't believe it. And then we're going to be starting Queer Magic, which I'm super, super excited about. I'm so excited to be reading Queer Magic. It's going to be exciting. I haven't yet quite figured out how I'm going to break up the videos for this one, to be entirely honest. It's a lot. It's like a history book. So it's like a history class. But I am hoping that people will learn a lot because there is so much good information in here. Okay, I love you. Let's finish up with the daily. Excuse me, Garrett. Thank you. Let's finish up with the daily reading. And then let's get outside, go enjoy the weather, take our own little selah, you know, but anyway. Okay. All right. What type of energy are we working with today, folks? To protect ourselves, to create our boundaries, to flow with our own unique, magical spirits and gifts. I'm really hoping I can get one to come out. And there we go. Thank you. Oh, we got this one the other day. Energize yourself with the weather. That's a good one. Maybe it's, I don't know. I mean, sunshine, I'm in the Pacific Northwest right now, so it's like a lot more rain than I'm used to, but I hope everyone is enjoying lots of sunshine. But enjoy the warm sunshine, the wind in the trees, the cleansing rain, or the clarity after a snowstorm. This will increase your aliveness. Go outside, go breathe some fresh air, get some feet in some grass, let the sun soak on your skin. And I just wish you all have a wonderful day. And I love you. You take care. We'll see you tomorrow. I love you. Bye.